I will go without video, but I'm Adriano Scibilia. I'm a researcher at the National Research Council of Italy in the Institute of Intelligent Industrial Technology for Advanced Manufacturing, so-called STIMA. Today we'll talk about the issues on safety on collaborative robotics and how we address this issue in our project cover. Can you see my full screen presentation right now?
Yes, we can see it perfectly.
Okay. So this is a quick summary of the presentation I will do today. The structure on background of testing procedure for human-robot interaction. So and the need of this testing procedure in our applications. Then the cover ambition and how the project is defined and structured, and the approach of cover to validation at the system level, cross-domain perspective, and the development of protocols, which are the main output of the cover project. And then we will have the conclusions. So, as you know, human-robot collaboration have developed a lot in last years. Caused the development of collaborative robotic application in a lot of domains, different kind of environments, and with the years, the human-robot physical interaction has become closer and closer, and increase the need of testing procedure of various nature for the certification of products, robotic systems, and so on. A quotation from the Horizon 2020 Research Product Guideline is that the development of common approaches and tools is strongly encouraged. And the safety domain is a part in particular. This is valid in particular for the safety domain, in which we know that we have in parallel a lot of needs of testing procedure, a lot of different systems, but common problems. So this is an example of overview of different kind of testing procedure and how they are mentioned in the available standards. So the available standards and regulations are divided in different domains. The system are detailed and specifically divided. And in each of these standard, which you can see on the left side of the table, have a test that can measure the exchange power and force after a physical contact between a robotic system and a person. Detection test, as Scava project will illustrate later. Physical hazards, dynamic stability, and so on. And also we have tests related to safety also in standards on directive that are not explicitly related to safety. So you can imagine the amount of need of these kind of tools. How is the risk reduction procedure nowadays? As you may know, all starts with from the manufacturer of the robotic system. The guidelines for the initial risk assessment that has to be performed by the manufacturer are to analyze the product limits, which can be of various nature, about position, force, and so on, depending on the robotic system and on its supposed application. Because every risk is not related, as we know, to the machine, but is related to the use of the machine, to the intended use, how the system is supposed to be used. What are for each intended use the safety requirements of the system, and how is the supposed user main feature? So we have an initial risk reduction, as you can see from the picture on the left side of the figure. The measure of the manufacturer have to analyze the safeguarding measure, so the physical feature of the system to reduce the initial risk level, safeguard and protective measure, tools such as skin on the robotic systems, for example, and so on, to reduce physical hazards, and then provide information on the intended use to the end user, so that the end user can analyze if also the operators needs further instruction on that. After that, we have an initial risk reduction level, as we can see in the middle of the figure. The end user must analyze if the residual risk is acceptable or not. In case it is not, a further reduction is needed. Analyze the internal, and to do that, the end user must analyze the internal conditions, special hazard working conditions, what is supposed to be the activities near the product or the robotic system, if unintended uses are possible or not, and reschedule its organizational processes and its physical feature of the operational workspace according to the intended application. After that, add also protective equipment, laser scanner and so on, to separate workspaces between the robot and human where needed. So after that, the residual risk must be acceptable. If we translate this concept on robotics, for example, we have that the manufacturer have to follow the law directive, which is the machinery directive 2006, in which the robot is considered a partly completed machinery. A robotic system is a machine, on the other hand. So robotic system integrator and end user have to analyze the robot, which the manufacturer has to deliver with the product limits, intended use, and the guideline I illustrated before, but have to analyze safety issues and the hazard not on the partly completed machinery, so the robotic arm, but the robotic system. As we said before, is the application that drives us through a safe behavior of our products. So, what is COVER? COVER, so called also being safe around collaborative and versatile robot in shared spaces, is a European project funded by Horizon 2020, which has the ambition of boosting the spread of cobots in different application domain and promoting the culture of safety in human-robot interaction. To do so, the COVER main partner, which are five research centers, the CNR, as you saw, in Milan. Then we have CEA in France, RRD in Netherlands, Fraunhofer, IFF Fraunhofer Institute in Magdeburg, Germany, and the Danish Technological Institute in Denmark. The all partners developed these issues and in the following point. We provided an open COVER toolkit, as Julia mentioned before, to assist coboters to develop along the whole system cycle. So from the beginning of the definition of the characteristic of your application to the testing procedure that you need to perform, as we will see later in detail. Reduce the time and complexity in verification of cobot safety, developing validation testing protocols, as we know, the final output of the whole process, and last but not least, create a community of test hubs, open labs, in which end users can perform such testing procedures and create shared knowledge about the issues on collaborative robotics certification process, because as you know, common procedures are strongly encouraged. So this is the cycle of development of the protocols and on the toolkit. So it's a cyclic process, because the toolkit provides guidelines and information what testing procedure in different domains must the user do, which will end in a so-called testing protocol with detailed description of the step-by-step guide. But this is a feedback, continuous feedback, and is updated and corrected for the more the 60 funded project that the COF community funded, such as SCAVA project that will be illustrated later, for example. We have the COVR community is composed by more than 40 technology developers, 36 RTO or university, 40 end user, and 12 system integrator, and also others from 14 countries all over the Europe. The COVR community project, funded project, has the aim of being in different domain fields so that we can address in parallel the issues that can be characteristic of different domain. We can have agriculture, we have assistive medical robotics, rehabilitation robotics, we have industrial robotics, manufacturing, and so on. So, COVR fundament in the end, to sum up, to development testing protocols with an approach valid for several domains with a pre-standardization output. So, traditionally standard, the different domains are separated. But we see that some testing procedures have been included into standard with different level of detail and what they test. The unified testing procedure, on the other hand, that COVR proposes are common, identify the common feature and common safety skills, as we will illustrate illustrate the concept of safety skill later, not questioning the standards and their validity, but helping the standards to reach the final user. And then, of course, continuous feedback and validation of the developed protocols. So this is the design phase of safety certification process and of a protocol from Inspiration Technology Scan, so available technology to do the intended use of the application. Then requirement specification for the process, the design of physical feature of the system, the implementation, verification and validation of the procedure, and then the operation. So to do so, the community of Coboters can perform the realistic trials, the testing protocols, which are available on the toolkit. To do so, they are guided in the toolkit that we will see later from the definition of the system to the end. COVR community support shares facilities to the Coboters so that is not to not have the barrier of having to buy expensive equipment, which is really specific for this kind of tests, and the community, each end user cannot every time buy different testing equipment or sensor for each test that they need to do. So we did an open lab approach all around Europe, the main partner, but also other institutes, to allow to have a shared facility in which the test can be performed. So the protocols are updated with the feedback of the Coboters, but also under experts from the legal point of view, ethical committee, and so on. This is the toolkit. As you may see, there are different tabs. The end user is guided to have to explore the standards and directives, putting the domain of application in the upper left side of the toolkit, and then in the upper right side, the specific robot platform to access the standard. On the other end, in the protocols tab, you can see on the left, we don't have a separation on different domains. But we have the kind of robotic system, and as you can see on the upper right side, the feature that you want to test. You can have maintain safe distance, dynamic stability, and so on. These are the so-called safety skill that is the concept that he introduced to have common approaches in different systems. Before explaining that, we have also the tab of testing equipment available in the shared facilities, so that the end user can explore if the specific sensor needed by him is available in one of them or more than the shared facilities. We also have publication tabs and so on, scientific publication, also case stories, which are the different stories of the project in the different domains all around Europe that we will that we financed and we worked with. Also, SCAVA project will be here with our pleasure at the end of it. So, the validation that CORE proposed, as I mentioned before, this is a systemic level. It's not the different component, verification of each component. So, as we say, we see the different domains have parallel identical procedure, which are different from domain to domain. CORE toolkit provides the first information so that the user have to focus only on the system level validation. The final validation of the complete robotic collaborative robotic system and the feature that want to be explored. So the cross-domain procedure is to respond to the common approach requirement of the research project Horizon 2020. So to avoid overlap of behaviors and identify common safety requirements, simplifying the identification of testing procedure. This is an example of what I'm telling about common feature. Here we have, for example, two different kind of robot. We have a mobile robotic platform and a moving part of a robotic arm. On the wall depicted in the figure on the left, we have a sensor which is used for testing power and force limitation, so the energy exchange after an impact. We see that we have two different behavior and two different robots, but a common measure, a common feature, which is the limitation of physical interaction energy. So here we have the fundamental concept that was introduced in the CORE project. The safety skill. So we have to avoid confusion with standards and with definitions. So what is a cobot? Cobot is the platform. Collaborative industrial robot, exoskeleton, and so on. Different for each different application. But the safety skills is an abstract representation of the ability of the robot system to reduce a risk. So, is an abstract concept that is common and it can be implemented in different way and may derive different feature when applied to different domains. But the concept is one and only. Is defined irrespective but when it is implemented due to an inherent design of the future and or dedicated risk reduction measure and policy. So the safety skill, limited interaction energy, dynamic stability and so on can be verified and implemented in different ways by the so-called testing protocols. Here is an example of different safety skill and how they are mentioned in different standards. Time safe distance, so the speed and separation monitoring, for example, in 15.066 standard, and so on. Maintain dynamic stability, the PFL, so power force limitation, which is limit physical interaction energy because have also equivalent on other domains that is not the industrial robots, and so on, because we are running out of time. So the end of this process is a so-called protocol, step-to-step by step guide on how to execute a safety skill validation measurement. What is the scope of a protocol? Increase the familiarity of roboticists with possible measuring techniques. So how to face complex problem because this kind of system are different complex issues. Inform protocol user what aspect of the risk analysis and system behavior are relevant for validation. Not all the aspects are relevant to safety. We have to identify what are measure fundamental for safety or not. We have a division of the protocol from introduction to objective, so the characterization of hazards, the metrics of the hazard to be analyzed, the condition of the system, environmental condition, so from indoor industrial environments to outdoor agricultural environment, which has different light condition, temperature, humidity, and can lead to different environments that can affect testing measures. So a description of the setup, sorry, of the testing setup, the most general possible. And then a step specific step-to-step guide on testing procedure, practices, how to analyze data and record sheets for relevant information for the end user. So this will help detail in, with a level of generality, but also detail the end user to have a so-called certification testing measure. Not testification, testing measure to allow the certification of a collaborative robotic application. So, in the end, CoVR was funded with the purpose of filling the gap between regulation and users. So, CoVR is in the middle between standards and the application of the real robotic systems. Different testing protocols were developed with an approach very valid for several domains. We provide additional testing procedure, not questioning standards, but helping them. The safety skill concept, which was introduced by the CoVR project, helped to avoid overlaps and to allow a cross-domain approach, so a common approach for different problems, identify the common issues. And last but not least, the CoVR community, which was really strong in this year, which is in these more than three years of CoVR project, helped to spread awareness, join the efforts, analyze the issues on different platforms, in different domains and platform. And we saw that a lot of interests is by system developers and research centers in Europe that were waiting for a community to help them to spread knowledge on this. So research and standardization can have a joint effort and go together through the self-consciousness of selfie certification process. That's all for me. Sorry for the little delay. And if you have questions, I'm available later for you.
Thank you very much, Adriano, for your presentation. Now, I will give you a quick introduction to Discover project, and I would like to do it by showing you the brand new video that we produce for the project. Please let me know if you can hear it. I kindly ask maybe Siva to give me a confirmation.
Yes. Can I turn up the
Perfect.
Volume, maybe?
Yes.
Nowadays, the role of robots collaborating with humans in industrial environments is crucial. As a consequence, the effective and safe interaction between
That's better, thank you.
Is of paramount importance. Any risk for the human introduced by machinery is to be mitigated through protective measures. In Scava, the validation of the protective measures equipped with 3D cameras is defined to always ensure the safety of the worker during collaborative activities with the robot. The panorama of the international standard is so wide that often it's difficult to figure out the way to validate the actual devices in the right field of application. The COVR project aims to provide support for this issue. The validation of stereo vision sensors is in the scope of the SCALA project. Datalogic defined the protocol to validate two stereo camera models capable to detect the body and arm of a worker. The testing was structured following the COVR guidelines for test validation. The new protocol is in line with the international standard on video-based protective devices using stereo vision techniques and represents a significant step forward for all actors involved in human-robot collaboration. The Scava project is the result of the fruitful collaboration between Datalogic and Chris, with the support of the CML Schema from the COVR project.
Okay, so with this very quick video, we wanted to give you some information about the project, and I'm going to summarize all these in my presentation before leaving the floor to Gianluca from Datalogic. So in the Scava project, we wanted to strengthen to answer to a question which is today more than ever relevant for for all companies working with industrial robots, that is, can operators and robots share safely the same workspace? So it seems a rhetoric question, but it is not, since in order to guarantee the safe interaction between operators and robots, we need to implement protective measures which must be compliant with international standards. And this is the purpose of the SCAVA project, which sees as Datalogic, global leader in factory automation, as main partner, with the support of CRIT for communication and dissemination activities, and CNR Stima as mentor from the COVER project, working on this challenge. We mainly wanted to develop a validation method, which is based on and specifically implemented on two stereo camera models, which were developed by Datalogic within the Rossini project, and which represent vision-based protective devices. And this is the specific object of the SCAVA project. SCAVA, of course, stands for stereo camera validation. In these 9 months activities, what we did, what Datalogic mainly did with the support of CRIT, is implementing 4 activities, as you can see from this slide. So first of all, by using the COVER guidelines and toolkit presented by Adriano, Datalogic adapted its labs and used the best practices and criteria developed in the COVER guideline to validate its stereo cameras. The result is the development of a validation protocol which want to assure the efficient safety assessment of stereo cameras, and is a document, the main output of this project. But developing a protocol implies also working on the existing documents that are already accepted and validated at the international level. So in order to produce a valid document, a valid protocol, Datalogic started by mapping and identifying currently missing safety features in commercial product robots, but also considering current gaps in existing standards at the European and international level. Of course, Datalogic did this starting from the point of view of a camera, of a safety camera manufacturer. The main output of the project are then testing and providing a feedback of the COVER toolkit, developing our own methodologies to validate stereo cameras, but also collecting and analyzing data from Multis process, which are helpful to improve the performance of the stereo cameras developed by Datalogic. These results, which are the main output of SCAVA, are relevant not only for Datalogic and for its sectors, but can be replicated in many other industries, from logistics to pharma, from ceramics to mechanics. So we provided contents that have a wide impact for the industrial environment at the European and international level. As I said, so this is a brief description of the activities developed by CRIT as communication and dissemination manager of the project. We wanted to ensure a widespread visibility of the SCAVA results. So we started by launching SCAVA on social media and website, producing press releases that were launched at the regional, national and European level, and developing dissemination activities to guarantee the communication of SCAVA results to important industry and research stakeholders, including the video that I've already showed you, the case story that was presented by Adriano in his presentation, and of course today's event. I've already showed you the video, so these are my contacts if you want further information about SCAVA, but now I will leave the floor to Gianluca Giorgio from Datalogic to present the activity, the technical activities by Datalogic. Thank you. So Gianluca, when you want, you can start sharing your screen.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to share my screen. Can you see?
Yeah, we see your desktop now.
Can you see the presentation?
Also some background noise. Okay, now it's perfect. Okay, you can start. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here. I'm Gianluca Giorgio. I'm working in Datalogic. I'm going to describe to you the technical activity that we developed in the SCAVA project for validation of a stereo camera in compliance to IC61496. In the summary, I put also some information about me and company and general information about SCAVA project, and then we go down deeper in data analysis and the SCAVA test protocol. Okay, I'm Gianluca Giorgio, I'm an electronic engineer. I'm working in functional safety for 7 years, and in Datalogic I'm working on design and validation of a functional safety system. I'm also certified as functional safety professional. Datalogic is a global technology leader in different fields of factory of different markets and industries, founded in 1972, and now is accounting more than 450 engineers in our research and development center. SCAVA project is mainly based on this project plan, where we had two milestones at month 5 and month 9. In the first milestone, we developed some deliverables about a starting analysis of the panorama of the standard needed for the validation, because we were developing a stereo camera for our for a different European project, and we find us in the situation of validating or at least to understand how to validate that eventually, and we figure out that there are some gaps in the current standards, that is mainly IC61496, that is the standard for video-based protecting device based on stereo technologies. At the same time, we need also to integrate this stereo camera in a protecting device that is also based on a controlling part, and this to be then integrated in a robotic application where the functional safety requirements are coming from the typical standard that we have in the machinery field, S15849 or 62001. So we developed all our study, and then we define already a first draft of the test protocol for public use in the toolkit of COVER, and then also we evaluated a test protocol that was already present in COVER toolkit, because it was useful to understand the usability of this test protocol and any possible improvement. Then in second milestone, we completed our analysis. We collected data for the validation of, or at least for the evaluation of this stereo camera, and then we also defined the final public draft release, I would say, of the test protocol. Let's go to see something more. Basically, the main project tasks are the data analysis for the characterization of stereo camera, both for arm and body detection capabilities, and then the test protocol for the validation of the visual-based protecting device based on stereo technologies. About the first task, okay, as I said, we studied all the panorama of the possible standard applicable, because our final intended use is for human-robot collaboration application. And so going back from this topic that is basically addressed by ISO TS 15066, then going back to the standard of robotic that are the series ISO 10218, we recognize that all the requirements for functional safety are collected in 13849 or 62061 or 61508. Then these standards are defining as reference for development of protecting device based electrosensing protecting device the series IEC 61496, and specifically for video based for the stereo technologies the parts 4-3. So after this study we had all the elements to develop the system in develop and validate the system in compliance to what are the requirements defined by the all the different standards involved, and that is basically a PLD category 3 or a SIL2 hardware fault tolerance 1 that is addressed by the specific standard of the stereo video based protecting device based on stereo technology by iType 3 ESP. This is the starting point of our work because, okay, we have the standard, we have the type of device that we have to comply with, but we have different needs with respect to the standard because, okay, the standard is basically addressing protecting device in which we are monitoring a generic industrial scene. We need also to transport this application to a robotic application, and overall we have also the need of fuse and to use more than one stereo camera in some application for additional benefits to our monitoring. And these are all features that were not addressed by the standard. This is the reason why we need to recognize a different way, starting from the standard, to characterize and validate our sensor, our vision sensor. This is what we developed, is our prototype that we developed in a different project. Is a typical stereo camera. We can see the left and right sensor that are producing the stereo image, and then other additional stuff that are useful for the production of the depth images. Here are more or less summarized the main characteristic of this stereo vision sensor that is working basically at the infrared wavelength and is working at up to 40 frames per second. We developed two kinds of sensor, one for arm detection and one for body detection capability. And for both, we had the need to understand how to go towards the validation, possible validation of this kind of device in a future, at least in a future, because now it's a prototype and not a product. But if, and on the other end, together with Cover project, there was the need to provide something that was useful for the validation of a generic stereo camera. And so these two joint needs take us to develop this SCAVA project. So we defined, starting from the standard, all the testing conditions that are made of different parameters. Basically, working with a short and a long baseline depending on the arm detection and body detection capabilities, along with other features that I'm not specifying. And then we define different testing conditions based on different distances of the background, so different distances of the object from the image sensor, different test pieces, because each detection capability is requiring a different shape and different dimension of the test piece to be tested, to be used for testing, and with different diffuse reflectance that are basically based on a specific color with specific characteristics that we studied and that we has to be parametrized with respect to the standard at the infrared wavelength. Then also the position of the piece can be in the center of the image or in the corner. Then we will see after we see some example. And also we were interested to recognize all the possible behaviors of the system in different interferences condition, basically about light, but also about light condition, but also about occluding and physical object, occluding object. Also, the background can have its impact, because basically the tests are performed with a gray background, but for interfering testing with a background, we use also different pattern on the background of the test. The camera the camera is always used in with HDR mode, and the test performed are at least the one that we are going to represent here are listed in the last column. The test piece that we are mentioning, I was mentioning before, are, for example, of this type. On the left, we can see the type of arm for arm detection that is basically a reproduction proposed by the standard of an arm, and with different colors, so with diffuse reflectance. In this case, we are only seeing the white and gray. For what concerns the black. The body detection capability, we can see instead the black one and the retro reflective one that is obtained by coating with specific characteristic that are obviously indicated by the standard. So we collected and processed the data to understand what we concentrate. At the end, in our analysis, we recognize the need to work not only on the final behavior of the protective device, but to find a way to recognize in the depth image quality the characteristic to understand if what are the parameters or what are the elements to be used at system level to understand if the camera is behaving in the right way or not, and if it's not behaving the right way, how to recognize it. So our needs is about to understand if the image are reliable, or if not reliable, it can happen that are inherently safe with a certain use at system level, or are not reliable. So we have only to manage the issue at system level by, for example, reaching a safe state. This analysis is based on parameters as the fill rate of the world, that image of region of interest that are defined basically on the test piece, and also by the computation of the mean error and standard deviation in this specific region of interest. So we performed mainly some main tests. We recognized more interesting tests proposed by the standard, and we collected the depth image and the data retrieved from the depth image to understand what is the evaluation, the characterization of the stereo camera. we performed the tolerance zone test that basically is a starting test that is to be performed to define what is a fundamental characteristic of the sensor, that is the sensor uncertainty, because based on thousands of distance measurement and the computation of the mean error and standard deviation, you can define the sensor uncertainty that is basically the uncertainty of the sensor that can be used in the formula of speed and separations monitoring that is proposed in ISO-TS 15066. But this kind of information can be also used to define a sort of tolerance zone, a sort of area, rounded area in the detection zone, that is the area where the behavior of the system can be not 100% sure. So the detection of the object entering the detection zone can be not completely reliable. This is the reason why you have to foresee a sort of buffer zone around the detection zone to that is due to the sensor uncertainty to ensure the safe detection of the object. Then we perform sensing distance test, that are basically the test functional test performed in normal condition, that then we processed and analyzed in with different parametrization with respect to the distance of the test piece from the camera, with respect to the different diffuse reflectances of the test piece that we see before, depending on the color, and with respect to test position in the plane of the image, I mean the center of the core or the corner of the plane of the image, and we recognize obviously that all this parametrization was producing results that were variable depending on these parameters, always in line with the worst case results that we observed in the tolerance zone test about the sensor uncertainty, but obviously give the possibility to, for example, characterize the behavior of the camera with respect to this parameter, and if you are able to do that in real time, at runtime, you can manage better that image depending on the position of the object in the scene, the monitor scene at runtime. Then we started also with tests about interference. One was the with the incandescent lamp, in which basically we point the incandescent lamp towards the sensing device or towards the background and the test piece, and basically we recognize with different level of illumination that are suggested by the standard that only at 3000 lux towards the sensing device we recognize some effect that are to be detected at system level to avoid the failure to danger. So this is one of that case of the cases in which even if you are not able to detect the test piece or the scene, you at least need to be able to recognize the interference condition and stop, for example, in an application where our protecting device is controlling a robot, for example, you have to stop the robot. Then we performed also a laser beam interference test, in which in this case you can see that the laser is pointed towards the sensing device, in particularly in the left sensor of our stereo camera. And this is something that is can produce, because the laser is a red laser and the camera is working at infrared, but sometimes can produce a spot in the image, in that image, that is to be managed at system level, because this spot can produce a sort of occupation of virtual object in the image, and this to be managed is to be managed at system level. We performed also tests with stroboscopic and flashing beacon interference, but we figure out that no impact have been observed and nominal function is always ensured. With fluorescent lamp, only with a fluorescent lamp at high frequency, we recognize some effect that can be managed at system level. That can be, for example, some invalid pixel in the and so a fill rate of the image that is, for example, going down. We, as I said, also perform a test with the interferences, passive interferences on the background, where we put a checkered, a squared, a dotted, or a hexagonal, say, pattern, and we recognize that in all these cases, the test demonstrate a normal function thanks to optical design measures that are already in place in our developed stereo camera. Obviously, this is something that is to be managed if a stereo camera developer wants to develop a stereo camera and validate it also against this kind of interference. Other tests are the management of the active projected pattern that we have inside the stereo camera. That can be, for example, completely lost or partially lost. In this case, we observe the degradation of the measure that is to be managed at system level. In case instead of low or fading light, we recognize no effects on that image, because that was something expected, because the camera is working at infrared. And then also we produce also manual interference, optical occlusion and pollution tests that are different tests in which we produce a sort of, we can say, a physical obstruction to the camera, and we recognize different, say, virtual object produced by the real object in the depth image that are to be managed depending also on their position inside the image by the eventual controller, safety control, that has to work with the depth image. So once completed all this work of standard analysis, data collection, data processing and analysis, so we have all the elements to understand how to work with this camera at system level, and so to how to define a test protocol to test a video-based protecting device based on stereo techniques that is not requiring to manage or to evaluate the depth images, but is requiring only that in all these different scenarios and situation, how to manage the situation to, for example, recognize the detection condition and so send an opportune output signal, or to go to safe state in case the behavior of the observed scene is not under control. Okay, I go faster because we are late. And so we defined that we had the opportunity to test an existing cover protocol test protocol in which we used a test setup similar to the one that we are going to propose also for our test protocol, and we recognize that the solution proposed by the cover protocol was about the presence of the human inside the scene, was better obtained, the behavior of the camera was better validated by the use of our test piece that is more repetitive and more deterministic with respect to the distance measurement. Then we worked on our validation, which we have a safety function to validate. It is basically the stop request to avoid dangerous contact, and once stopped, the system shall also maintain the stopping condition as soon as the dangerous condition for a collision are detected. This is our safety skill is the position detection of a human operator present anywhere inside the detection zone, and we defined a test setup with the camera placed in a top view position and using our test pieces and our background in different position on the floor. We have proved our test protocol to be sure that is usable for a future user. And so we defined this test plan with different test cases in which a part of the tolerance zone test that is used for mean error and standard deviation computation, the other tests are all basically figuring out the metric that is detection or not detection, and where needed for interferences condition, an opportune safe state. We produced a testing documentation tool to be used for planning the testing and also for reporting the results. So a test plan, a test case, a test summary, and test report. And we, as I said, we proved with our setup, our test protocol in all these test cases. Here we can observe our camera mounted on top. This is the, for example, one test piece with the background, gray background, and this on the right we can observe all the test setup picture. We use, for example, the setup for arm detection in the image corner, so we can observe here the background where we are going to put the test piece. In this moment, in the depth image, we have no detection, and the semaphore is green because there is no detection. When the object is inserted in the scene, we can see that the depth image is capable to recognize that, and also the controller is capable to recognize this detection and to send a stop to the robot that we can recognize with the semaphore light red. The same we have done also with a different test piece that is not the gray one, but is a black one. We did the same with the body detection, in this case in the center of the image, and we had the same result. What we can observe in this case is that we used also the retroreflective coating on the body test piece, even if the depth map is providing some invalid pixel inside the contour of the test piece, the result is in any case good because the protecting device is in any case capable to stop the robot. Then we can also summarize very, very rapidly some environmental interference. Here we can observe the incandescent lamp on the sensing device. Here is the effect of the incandescent lamp on the background, and here the effect of a pollution on the window, optical window. This is not seen in gray level image because it's obviously put on the left in left sensor, and so in all these cases, as before, the detection is perfectly performed. In this case, instead, this object put on the optical window is producing a very big dots of agglomerate of invalid pixel that in any case is recognized at system level and is taking the system in a safe state. This is all. These are my contacts. If you have the curiosity of additional question, and for the general information about the project, you, as you already know, this is CAVA project stereo camera validation and involving Datalogic, Qt, and the cover.